our response, that we are light. And so the key thing is that, you know, as I meditated a bit on this, the Bible says that God is light. Now, for you to be light, you have to get your light from him. The Bible says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Now, basically what is happening is that in the midst of this inflation, Christians, and the Bible is there, it says the heart of many will fail them. But the reality is that you need to shine. And the only way you shine is by being in the light. The Bible says God is in light that cannot be approached. So the key thing is that you can, because Christians quote this scripture, but the reality is that it is in his light that I get light. It is in his light I get light. So you cannot shine without God giving you his light. And that's why it says, but Yahweh rises upon you and the brightness of his glory appears over you. So when people ask, how are you doing it? You basically don't have an answer, but it is a function of his light. You know, the Bible says there's a spirit in man in Job 32, verse 8. It says there's a spirit in man and it's the breath of the Almighty that gives him understanding. A version says that gives him intelligence. So what is our response in this? Is that we must go to the light. You cannot shine in this hyperinflation period without having light. And that's why you see that currently in Nigeria, why do we say people need to pray? The reality is this, is that certain people are going for political power. And why do they need political power? Because they need the light. Don't forget, the Bible says that the devil appears as an angel of light. So there is a light also that comes from the devil. But you know, it's not the real. So that's why you see two sets of people. So you see people ruling and you're like, these people are not godly. But the reality is that they have access to the light that the devil gives. And so your response must be that, number one, the theories are there, the principles are there. But number one is that you must be in the light. You must acquire and allow God's light shine on you. In 2 Corinthians 3, verse 18, it says, we all, as with unveiled faces, are being transformed from glory to glory by the Spirit of the Lord. So I will appeal to everyone on this platform. It's not a function of numbers and all of that, but I will appeal to everyone on this platform. Seek his light. It is in his light that you would be light. Praise the Lord. So as I looked at this, God led me to this. What is our response? Our response is Goshen. You must have a Goshen plan. You know, and what is Goshen? It's a light in the darkness. Remember that Sinach song? That is who you are. You are the light in the darkness. In Exodus 8 verse 2, God said, I will set apart. He says, I will set apart in that day the land of Goshen, in which my people dwell, that no swarm of flies shall be there. To the end you may know that I am the Lord in the midst of the earth. I am the Lord in the midst of the earth. And in Exodus 10:22, it says they did not, this was when there was darkness all over Egypt. And it says they did not see one another, nor did anyone rise from his place for 3 days. But all the children of Israel had light in their dwelling. So what am I appealing? Do you know, when I checked, do you know what the meaning of Goshen is? The meaning of Goshen is draw near. D-R-A-W, draw near. So when you say you want to be, like I said earlier, is that for you to live in Goshen, you have to draw near. You have to draw near to the light. You see, this is not the period where you begin. It's good to analyze. But you see, analysis without faith in God leads to failure. This is the period that you have to be anchored. The Bible says Christ in us, the hope of glory. You have to anchor your faith. And that's basically now, I I don't rationalize so many things again. All I look for is, Lord, what are you saying? And I place my anchor on it. Last week, I had to take a decision. And I was like, oh, how do I go about this? Oh, this one might cost me much. But I knew I had peace about it. And everything went well. You know. So why am I saying this? You have to decide. You see, what I'm saying is that in this period and time, you have to decide to live in Goshen, which is where God is. Now, what is our response in harsh times? Like I said, these are just the scriptures, the Holy Spirit. He says, and this is the story of Elisha. He says that the word of the Lord came to Elijah, live here, turn eastward and hide in the Crit ravine, east of Jordan. You will drink from the brook and I have directed the ravens to supply you with food there. So he did what the Lord had told him. He went to the ravine east of Jordan and stayed there. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. You know, what is our response? My brothers and sisters, in this season, expect manna. When God showed me the scripture, I said, what's this? He said, number one, in this season, expect manna. What is manna? Manna is supernatural provision. You know, it's good to work hard because the Bible says in Proverbs, the hand of the diligent bear rule. But in this season, there's supernatural provision. So that is one. Because the Bible says, I have directed the ravens. It wasn't Elijah's faith that brought the ravens. It was God directing them. So there are certain people you do analysis. You do, and there's nothing wrong with that. You're a process person. But the reality is that in this season, you must create opportunity for God to intervene. That is one. Number two is that, you must also listen to what God is saying. Heidi, please unmute your mic. You must also listen to what God is saying. You see, the Bible says, and the word of the Lord came to Elijah. Please, you see, there's something, you know, there's this song I like. It talks about, I want to chill with the big boys, and so you have to run kitty kata. This is not a season where you run helter-skelter. Why? Because you see, when you run helter-skelter, you are going to spend from resources you don't have. This is a season where you need precision. You need precision. And so you need to work with God on a precision basis, which is, what should I do? He will tell you step one, step two, step three. You know. And so, like I said, what is our response? I've talked of one being in the light. Number two, you must expect manna. You must trust God for supernatural provision. And number three, you must listen to God. Why is this supernatural provision? Is that the ravens eat, they bring dead meat. The raven is actually what they call an unclean bird. But you see, what am I saying here? You must trust God for manna, meaning that trust God for supply from unusual sources. I have certain people who are on my client list. I won't say they are godly, but they are on my client list. I have some level of favor with them. So God can use the unlikely, but you must be open. You must be open. Praise the Lord. Now, the other thing is, something else happened. It says, sometime later, the brook dried up, and because there had been no rain, in the land, then the word of the Lord came to him, go at once to Zarephath in the region of... Heidi, please mute your mic, please. So, sorry about this. He says, then the word of the Lord came to him, go at once to Zarephath in the region of Sidon and stay there. I have directed a widow there to supply you with food. So he went to Zarephath. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar so that I may drink? As she was going to get it, he called and said, bring me please a piece of bread. Praise the Lord. Now, what is the instruction here? One of the challenges Christians have is managing transition. There were lots of churches when COVID hit and the churches had to close down. People thought it was the devil. But you see, it was a transition period. The brook dried up. The brook of physical services dried up. And some churches struggled. Why? Because they needed to go to Zarephath. What was Zarephath? They needed to use technology. You know, please, in this season, what should your response be? Be open to innovation. Because you see, when you are somewhere and it dries up, the key thing, like I said, God has made provisions. And how do you know? A word came. Now see the story and the thing. And this was Elijah. Elijah was a man of great faith. The first time he was enjoying manna, and there's a season manna will stop. And when manna stops, you need to go out. That's a difference. You know, in this inflation time, people behave like in Proverbs. They behave like a sluggard. It says a sluggard says there is a lion in the streets. Why was there a lion here? He was going from the known to the unknown, which was Zarephath. Zarephath is the region of Sidon. Now, this, if you read the Bible history, you know that this is an area they said it was dedicated to Baal. So you had idol worshippers there. Now, this was the scenario. I have directed a widow there to supply you with food. Now, what am I saying? For you to thrive in this time, you need a customer. Now, if you look at the profile of a widow is one of what you call in fact that was the customer. So the key thing is that in this season, you have to service some people. But hear the word God said. You know, in the other place, God said, I have directed the ravens. Now he said, I have directed a widow. What am I saying to you? Please, I beg, don't hustle. You need to ask God, who have you directed to me? Don't hustle. Who have you directed to me? It's not, you see, this period is not the period where you do in Psalm 127, rise up early, go back late, eating the bread of sorrow. Why? Because he gives his beloved sleep. And so you need to find out who God has directed you to. He said he had directed the widow woman to supply. Now he went to Zarephath, and this is where, you see, if you have a business, this is not the period where you close shop. This is where the period you have to engage. The Bible said when he got to the city gate, he saw this woman, and it wasn't the woman that called him. It was him that called her, and he made a request. So the key thing is, what is your prospecting plan? Who are you engaging? Especially those God has directed you to. You know, God can tell you, oh, this company, write them a proposal. Now you can think of it, this proposal will take too much time. I bind the devil. No, it's God. Because that's what happened to Elijah. I mean, he had people, he had ravens coming to him. But in this season, he had to go out and he had to engage. So what am I saying? You need to have God direct your engagement, but you need to engage. So if you're in a business where customers come to you, what I'm saying is that you need to start engaging, because one day the brook will dry up and those customers are not coming. Praise the Lord. Yeah. So the other thing was, this was another scripture God brought to my heart as I was meditating on this. He says, at that time, and these are all the things. What's your prophet model in harsh times? At that time, Ben-Hadad, king of Aram, pulled together his troops and launched a siege on Samaria. He says this brought on a terrible famine, and lots of people, families experiencing famine. So bad that food prices soared astronomically. My sister is in the food business. And oh, what you buy this week by next week is another thing. So what you buy and you don't sell off or you don't manage your pricing, you'll be shocked. Yes, you'll get the recording. Praise the Lord. And the Bible says 80 shekels for a donkey head. Now, I tried to do the math, but I think a donkey head is not even what the Israelites eat. And the key thing is that 5 shekels for a bowl of, now, five, let's say greens. And when I calculated this 5 shekels, it came to like 2,000 naira, like for a cup of beans. At least Nigeria is still better. But this is what they faced. Now, when I saw this, I was wondering, God, what is it here? And the Holy Spirit said, is that despite famine, people were still selling. Please keep selling. And in selling, the Bible is exact here. He gave us prices. So in this season, don't joke with your pricing. Don't joke with your pricing, but keep selling. Last week, to emphasize this, there was something the Holy Spirit led me to. I finished a transaction and I walked into a bank. I can't remember when last I entered the bank. And I just sat down there. And he was like telling me, you say the economy is down, but you see in that economy that is down, so that some people say Nigeria. I mean, that bank I entered, there were lots of people there. Some were queuing up to collect money. Some were queuing up to deposit money. So that's why the Bible says when they say there's a casting down, you have to say there's a lifting up. So what I'm saying here is that please keep selling. Keep changing and evolving your pricing to the realities of today. I'll give you a classic case, DSTV. I mean, DSTV premium now is 21,000. DSTV compact plus is 14,250. They've added 2,000 to it. And that's it. So what am I saying here? The truth is that if you have a good product, people will create the finance to buy the product. So make your product good. So, and that's the same thing. Maybe people will downgrade part of the DSTV, but they have their markets. So what am I saying here? Pricing is key. So don't be emotional about your pricing in this season. Don't be emotional. Imagine somebody selling a donkey head to Israelites that is a forbidden food, but it's the reality. So don't be emotional about your pricing, because the truth is that if I charge lower and somebody buys it and I cannot restock, I'm going to go out of business. So that's why the Bible praises men who step into deep waters. Praise the Lord. So when I go to a bit of a research and I look at it, so the key questions you need to ask yourself in this period and time, what are you offering the customer? Elijah offered the widow woman of Zarephath. How? He offered her sustainability. Because when he asked for the cake, she said, this is the last one. And he said, go make one. And the jar of oil will not finish. And the flour will not finish. So what was Elijah offering? He was offering sustainability. You know, people need to understand certain things about products. Don't look at your product from the physical perspective. Look at your product from what I call the unconscious thing your product does. It is why do people buy? Why would I still update my DSTV? It's the entertainment. It gives me to watch Arsenal. So you must ask yourself, what are you offering? What are you bringing to the table? The other thing is what I call, what is the value proposition that you have created? Now, this deals with your value chain. Now, the key thing is that in this period and time, you need to seriously look at your product, even your career. The truth is that currently careers, there are certain careers that are going to suffer. I knew somebody who has been looking for a job for a while and had to tell him, I said, that job role has been demoted currently. Organizations believe that anybody can fit into that job role. So my advice is go this route. Why? Because it has a higher value proposition. Please don't cry. You see, one thing I've learned is that people pay for value. So if your value is not up to, I mean, look at Ronaldo in Man U. He's collecting half a million per week. Why? It's value. So if I don't have the value of a Ronaldo and I'm crying, the truth is that I'm living in denial. So what do I tell people? Upgrade your value. Upgrade your value. You see, it's the same thing with God. The spiritual is to the highest bidder. If you go find out people that have been used of God or people that have been used of God, you need to know the sacrifices they've done. So the key thing is this. When you look at your product, what value is it? There's a girl I know, a Yoruba girl. I mean, this girl sells Bole, but she has so packaged it, the Bole comes, I mean, when you see the pack, it comes with pomo and all. I mean, it's Bole, and you're wondering. I mean, she supplies banks. She supplies high network, I mean, big parties. And when she comes, they say, is it not Bole? And I was a party and so on. This is Bole. Why? She understood the value that you see for that class of people. For a manager in a bank, he won't want his Bole served like it's a roadside Bole. So you must know what you create. The other part is your revenue. That was why I said something. You must keep updating your pricing. Because you see, you are in a business. The same thing with your career. I had to talk to a young man once. I even have a counseling session at the end of this. That you see, if your skill set is not matching your salary set, your expected salary, it means you are running at a loss. So you need to upgrade your skill set to match salary expectations. And it's the same thing with any business. Are you profitable? So you need to ask yourself, if this thing I'm selling, and that's why you see, please don't be deceived by turnover. Turnover is vanity. Oh, I made 20 million. It is vanity. Why? Because the key thing is, the question there is, are you profitable? Because when they give somebody 20 million, by the time the person does his analysis, he finds out that to get 20 million, he spent 21 million. And this is how business dies. Because their pricing is not strong enough, or they don't want to take that price decision. And that's why I said, in this season, you cannot be emotional about pricing. God, as long as God has directed customers your ways, he will provide people that can pay that bill. Now, so what are the things you need to do in this period? Now, two things I said. Now, these are for business people, but you can also apply for career. You need to look at your customer base, and you need to look at your product portfolio. I attended a seminar. I moderated a seminar yesterday, and as the speaker was talking, I had to write down certain things around new products. Because you see, how do you respond in this scenario? Isaiah 60 says, let your light shine. So you can look at your customer base. One thing is that you need new customers. And that's what happened to Elijah. He moved from the ravens as his customers to a widow of Zarephath. Now, so what are the things you need to do currently? You can either expand what you currently have to the customer base. What we call that is the share of wallet. What does that mean? Florence is my customer. But what I do is that I start putting some other things. Maybe I supply her, let's assume, milk. But what I do is that I increase the number of milk I supply her. It's called the share of wallet. So I can say, Florence, instead of buying 16 of milk, you know, with inflation, it's better you buy 12 so that in case the price doesn't change next week. So what you are doing is that, so you go to your existing customers and you ask yourself, what products do I have that I can still sell to them? It's called the share of wallets. Or you can look at a product that you already have. And that's why, like, what did Elijah do? He went out. So he tweaked an existing product. I mean, Elijah was anointed. Have you forgotten that this was the man that called down fire from heaven? So he had the anointing, but he had to go to a new customer with that anointing, the widow of Zarephath. So you can take your existing product, or even as I'm saying, somebody here is a career person. You can look at yourself and say, oh, nothing stops you from looking for another job. Nothing. So I'm in an existing job, but I can look for another job. So what you are doing is that I'm working, but I'm out there looking for a better job, which is a new customer. Or in the other side where it says new products, you can offer a new product, same value proposition to an existing customer. So I supply milk to Florence, and now I started getting tin tomatoes to Florence also. Now, when it comes to a career, it might be difficult for this, but the truth is that how? In career, what can you do to say you're offering a new product to an old customer? If you go and get a new certification, if you case, you upgrade your skill sets while working in that job, what happens is that because your value proposition has increased, you might get an increase in salary. It's all about, so when you look at a new product in a business, in a career line, it's a new level, a new skill set. And the same thing, you can get a new skill set and you go and look for another job. The current thing in the job is that currently IT skills are being valued high now. Currently, that's the trend. So you can say, oh, how do I digitalize my skill set and move from analog? Those are the things that these times are calling. Because all it's saying, so you have to look at your product, you have to look at your customer base. I'm sure there might be questions around this. I have to run for time. Now, so what did I say as I summarize a bit of this? And for those that are online, thank you so much. Number one, you must strengthen your pricing power. Don't be afraid in pricing. So how do you strengthen your pricing power? You have to behave as an like Shell. One of the things I give it to them in Shell is that, look, Shell has information. So when they even give you a contract, they even know how much you are going to make. And so sometimes, especially small SMEs, you don't do what we call a price analysis. You can do your own mystery shopping. My sister runs like an eatery. You can take a walk around the other places and sample their prices so that you know if you are still competitive. Like today, I went somewhere, I went to an eatery, and there's this drink I like to buy. So when they sold it to me, I now said, you people are more expensive. Your own is 100 naira. And the girl said, it's just 100 naira. I said, if I take this drink once a day, that's 700. In a month, it's 2,800. But what am I saying is that, I mean, this place is like 10 minutes from each other, 10, 15 minutes. And one place has 100 naira on top. So you must learn to strengthen your pricing power. You must also prioritize what is your most profitable products. One of the things I've done is I've looked at my product portfolio, my service portfolio, and I've looked at, okay, this is the area I need to push. These are the target segments and all of that. You must prioritize. Why? Because margin is critical. And so these times, it is not, I sold 100 units. The question is, what was the profit from the 100 units? And so prioritizing your most profitable product is that, if I sell 100 of this, if I sell 100 of this, I will make this amount. I will make this amount. Let's assume I sell 100 of this, I make 50,000. I sell two of this, I make 100,000. So where should my priority be? Man, let me sell two of this. And that's why you see, when you go to ShopRite, there's a strategy they use. They tell you most affordable products and all that, but people have known that ShopRite is not the cheapest. But what does ShopRite do? Their most profitable products are the products they bring in front. So when you see, and that's what we call it shelf analysis. They look at the product that is fastest moving or the product that gives them more profit. They bring it to the front. Also, you must reduce consumption. And this was funny. When I was looking at it, and the Holy Spirit said, do you know what it took Elijah to be eating from ravens? His consumption was reduced. So what am I saying here? You know, in this hyperinflation period, money is not going to leave you in bulk. Money is going to leave you in trickles. Money will leave you in trickles. So you must learn to reduce your consumption. What is not necessary should go. So you must learn to reduce your consumption. You know, then you must also differentiate between strategic and non-strategic spending. What do I mean by that? The reality is this: sit down, you know, just like I talked about the product portfolio, you must also sit down and do your own spend analysis. I was discussing with somebody today and it was like, oh, there's this trip, oh, there's this person you need to meet. And former me, I would have tagged along in that trip. And I said, I didn't hear, I told myself, God, I don't think I've heard you concerning this trip. So I'm not going on this trip. But the trip looked nice, but I wasn't led. Because normally, you're traveling, we just enter plane and all that. And now with plane fees of 100, between 50 and 60,000, you know. So what am I saying? You must choose what is strategic and what is not strategic. And finally, you must learn to evaluate your supply chain risk. What is that? If you are in a business and you're supplying, you need to ask yourself. I mean, we're in a webinar yesterday and people were analyzing different things. Where can I get this product at this cost and all of that? You know, what it means is that you, and that's when you look at the Ahab story, which was, look, beans or green peas was for 5 shekels. So what that means is that you must really scout around. You must know, oh, I need to get this. What does that mean for you in a job? You need to ask yourself, you see, because in a job, there's digitalization, there's automation. You need to ask yourself, is this my job going to be automated in the next 3 years? That's a risk, meaning that they might not need me. I mean, I see people now, you work in a bank as a DSA, as maybe a teller and all that. Basically, in the banking structure, you don't really have a future unless you upgrade yourself. Because that role now has been downgraded. So it's the same thing. So you must evaluate that. Oh, this product I'm selling, can I restock it? How do I remember during that period of COVID, so many people suffered because they were getting things from China and China wasn't coming. So you must evaluate your supply chain risk. I know lots has been said. So I don't know if I can take 5 minutes questions. We keep to time. So we have like 8 minutes. Praise the Lord. If there are any questions.